Hi, everyone. Welcome to Church Online. Glad you've joined us. Hey, if you could do us a small favor, would you please help us spread the message of Jesus by giving this video a like or a share on social media? That would help us get the message of Jesus out. We are in Galatians chapter 2 today, verses 1 through 10. Let me pray, and then we'll get into it. Lord Jesus, thank you for this day. Thank you that your mercies are new every day. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that your presence is with us. And Lord, we just thank you for your love, your grace. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for being our Savior. Amen. Okay, so as I said, we're in Galatians chapter 2, verses 1 through 10 today. Let me read it to you, and then we'll dive into it. Then after 14 years, I went up, that's Paul, went up again to Jerusalem, this time with Barnabas. I took Titus along also. I went in response to a revelation and meeting privately with those esteemed as leaders. I presented to them the gospel that I preach among the Gentiles. I wanted to be sure I was not running and had not been running my race in vain. Verse 3. Yet not even Titus, who was with me, was compelled to be circumcised, even though he was a Greek. This matter arose because some false teachers had infiltrated our ranks to spy on the freedom we have in Christ Jesus and to make us slaves. We did not give in to them for a moment, so that the truth of the gospel might be preserved for you. As for those who were held in high esteem, Whatever they were makes no difference to me. God does not show favoritism. They added nothing to my message. On the contrary, they recognized that I had been entrusted with the task of preaching the gospel to the uncircumcised, just as Peter had been to the circumcised. For God, who was at work in Peter as an apostle to the circumcised, was also at work in me as an apostle to the Gentiles. James, Cephas, and John, those esteemed as pillars, gave me and Barnabas the right hand of fellowship when they recognized the grace given to me. They agreed that we should go to the Gentiles and that the Gentiles and they to the circumcised. All they asked was that we should continue to remember the poor, the very thing I had been eager to do all along. So this passage of scripture has a very specific theme, and that specific theme is unity. Unity in the body of Christ. Unity in the body of Christ. There's a lot of things that can separate us. There's a lot of things that can create differences in and among us. And really, those things often flow out of personal preference, personal things that make us comfortable. It's not even so much about the heart of God as it is so much about the heart of us that creates these differences and draws these lines that in this passage of scripture we especially see, and in others in the Bible, but this one as we're studying it, we see those lines removed. And we see the challenge to get rid of our selfish desires and just celebrate that Jesus is being preached. Let's unpack this ever so briefly. There are two things that are accomplished in these 10 verses. Number one, the proof that what the Judaizers were imposing on the young Galatian church and Christians was not necessary, specifically that they had to become as males, circumcised, and join the Jewish faith, and then they could become Christians. And so there was this molding of Jewish and Christian faith that the Judaizers wanted to impose. They wanted to impose more of the ritualistic and law type things onto the Christians in Galatia. And this was effectively a skewing of the gospel that is based more on freedom. And so here we have the fact that in verse 3, we see Titus was not even compelled to become circumcised. That is to say, there was no need for that. And so that is a proof that what the Judaizers were wanting the church in Galatia to participate in was not necessary. It was not necessary to become a Jew. It was more necessary simply to accept Christ as Savior and Lord. Number two, the second thing that happens in this passage of Scripture is Peter was called to the Jews and Paul to the Gentiles. Their Gospels were the same, only the people to whom they were sent to present the Gospel to were different. And one of the biggest examples of this that we see played out right in front of us that we often miss and we don't recognize that is even right in front of us, but it is in the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. We see in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John four different writers, each book written to four different groups of people, and each with a specific purpose. During the time of the Gospels, and the writing of the Gospels and the compiling of the Gospels, we have stories of Jesus that Jesus told. We have the parables that Jesus told. We have the miracles that he performed. We have the healings that he performed. And each of the Gospel writers, knowing that their audience would receive certain things certain ways, and it would either help or subtract from their purpose of presenting Jesus as Lord and Savior, they took these certain elements and they placed them in their books, in their writings, to these certain groups of people. And so, for example, we have Matthew. Matthew was a Jewish man writing mostly to a Jewish audience. Matthew's purpose was to convince the Jews that Jesus was the Messiah that the Old Testament prophesied about. Matthew, knowing that the Jews really honored and appreciated the authority of the Old Testament, uses a lot of Old Testament references to prove his point, similar like a lawyer would. Mark, on the other hand, Mark was a Jewish man writing to a Roman audience. Mark set out to tell his gospel in such a way that the Romans would be convinced that Jesus was God. Mark's gospel is the shortest gospel. He omits a lot of things that he knows the Romans wouldn't really care about. It's not necessary to them receiving Christ as Lord and Savior if they hear about specifically the virgin birth or the genealogy of Christ. They didn't need that kind of information to convince them. So he omitted that. You'll see in the book of Mark that there is no genealogy. The Sermon on the Mount is absent. The fact of the details around the birth of Christ, specifically that he was born in a stable and he was virgin, it was a virgin birth. He omits a lot of Jesus' longer teachings, and he makes them shorter. He did this because he knew that the Romans would be more impressed, it'd be more desirable to them to hear about the works of Jesus than about the words and teachings of Jesus. And so he focused on the actions and abilities of Christ than on what Jesus said. And all of this was simply because Mark understood his audience. He was going to present Jesus. That's the singular thing that every gospel presents, the gospel of Jesus, but it's done differently. We see in Luke is a Gentile writer. He was a doctor, and he focused on reaching specifically a Gentile audience. When Jesus was alive, there was a lot of groups that were considered to be outcasts or people that could be more considered like rejects. We got the lepers, the prostitutes, the sinners, the tax collectors, the Samaritans. And Luke set out to write a gospel that emphasizes that Jesus' love towards these groups it was very, very real. It is for this reason that in the book of Luke, we have the story of the prodigal son in chapter 15. We've got the story of the prostitute in chapter 7. We've got Zacchaeus, the hated tax collector, the wee little man Zacchaeus in the sycamore tree in chapter 19. That's a song I'm starting to kind of reference there from Sunday school, if you don't know. We also have the Good Samaritan in chapter 10. We have the 10 lepers in chapter 17. And then to cap it all off in the big climax and climactic moment of the cross, we have Jesus have a conversation with the sinner that was crucified next to him in chapter 23. Luke's intent was to show how Jesus shows grace to these groups, emphasizing the fact that Jesus did not just come for the religious Jew, Jesus came also for imperfect people like you and me. In the book of John, John's gospel is completely unique in that 93% of its content is not included in the other Gospels. John was writing to a general audience with an intent to persuade people that Jesus was God. John did that by focusing on the seven I am statements. I am the bread of life. I am the light of the world. I am the door. I am the good shepherd. I am the resurrection of the life. I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am the true vine. It is in these things that that John was trying to show Jesus as a deity. John also focused on eight miracles that he believed would prove Jesus is God. Water into wine, he heals the nobleman's son, he heals the lame man, he feeds the 5,000, he walks on water, he heals the blind man in chapter 9, and he raises Lazarus in chapter 11, who was dead, and he emphasizes the miraculous catch in chapter 21, so much so that it was amazing that the nets didn't even break, but they brought in, I think, I'm going from memory now, but I think it was 120 plus fish, and this was a massive catch of fish, and as the fishermen, as the disciples were out fishing, they hadn't caught anything all night, and Jesus yells from the shores, cast your net on the other side, and they do, and they catch a massive amount of fish, and they realize that this is the Lord on the shore, and they come and they have breakfast with him, and you can read more about that in John chapter 21. There's one gospel. Jesus is the only way to have relationship with God, restored with God the Father. Jesus is the only way. Accepting Jesus as your Lord and Savior, acknowledging that you need a Savior, acknowledging your sin, repenting of it, turning from it, allowing Jesus to wash you white as snow, and accepting Jesus as your Lord and Savior. It is only through Jesus. There's no other way. You can't work your way into heaven. You can't talk your way into heaven. You can't bribe your way. You can't buy your way. You can't do these things. You only can have salvation through accepting Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior. This is the singular message of the gospel. But here's the reality. Within the church, we get our personal preferences in there of how we want that message presented. And that comes down to what makes us comfortable, what we like. We have personal preferences, we have personal desires, we have personal likes. It's kind of like, even like just to break it down really, really simply, we've got all these different likes in terms of our personal palates in our mouths. We like certain foods, and certain people like certain things, and certain people don't like certain things. It's like some like spinach, others don't. Some like black licorice, others don't. Most everybody loves the red jujubes, but not everybody loves the black jujubes. There are personal preferences that can seemingly divide us. And what Paul is doing here is he is emphasizing the, and what is happening here is there's actually a challenge and a call to come together under the singular gospel and accept the reality that certain groups of people need the message of Jesus presented differently than you might like it to be presented. A stark contrast in the Christian world is the realities of music and musical preferences. And we often have that as a struggle within churches in terms of some people like the drums, other people don't like the drums. Guitar solos, not so much, and other people love the guitar solos. And they love the way the more contemporary, or they like the old hymns. Another example would be like in the inner city, rap music is a very big cultural and appreciated type of music. And so we have Christian rap music, and then we also have the Southern gospel music. Totally different, but both presenting Jesus. And the call here is drop your personal preferences and celebrate the singular gospel of Jesus Christ being proclaimed. Celebrate the singular gospel of Jesus Christ being proclaimed. This is a call to get over ourselves and to give those who preach the gospel with drums or no drums, in rap form or Southern gospel twang, to give those who present the gospel the right hand of fellowship. The right hand of fellowship. You know, there's a lot of times in the church where too often we've drawn lines in the sand and we've segregated and separated ourselves. The body of Christ is huge, and we need to accept and appreciate our brothers and sisters who preach Jesus, who serve Jesus, but look differently, like different things, maybe even act differently. Do they believe in Jesus as their Lord and Savior? That is the one unifying factor of the body of Christ. It's like in 1 Corinthians, we've got Paul emphasizing the unity in the body of Christ and emphasizing the different parts of the body and that not one is greater than the other. Listen, not one part of the body is greater than the other. We are the body of Christ and we need each other. I think that there is room from this passage of scripture to take time. There's room for us to take time to evaluate our personal hearts. Maybe we've been, we have not been Christian-like. We have not treated our brother and sister in Christ appropriately or properly as we should because of our personal preferences. And there might be a need for us to repent of that. There might be a need for us to ask for forgiveness of our brother and sister in Christ. If that's the case, I encourage you to do so. Church, what is most important? That Jesus is lifted high and proclaimed as our Lord and Savior. The mode in which it is done, not so important. But the person, the message of Jesus is the singular most important thing. And it is under Jesus that we are all unified. I think there's room for us to take time and repent if need be for our wrong heart attitude towards our brothers and sisters in Christ. And let's walk together with them from this moment forward. Together we are the body of Christ. Amen.